Amen.
You feeling good this morning?
Amen. Amen.
I want you to kindly turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. Gospel of John, chapter 1. Hallelujah. Might need a little bit of room for us. I need some running room. Thank you so much. The Gospel of John, chapter 1. How many know it's good to be in here today?
Amen.
It being the Sunday after Labor Day, I said, God, you know who's coming? You know who is a part of this journey that we're going upon and what it is we're going to be launching into here in the fall. We've got this fast coming up. Next Sunday we'll announce that and begin that week to fast as we feel led. And we'll be welcoming in new people this Tuesday night. We hope that you'll come if you feel led to join this awesome, awesome church. Amen. But let's look at the Gospel of John chapter 1. Nevertheless, there is a word for today. And where we are in this portion of Scripture, from the opening chapter of John's Gospel account, where John shows that God became human and came into the very world that He created through part of His own self, which was His Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. How many know God came to earth?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. And in the very verses that lead up to our text today, John declares how the world did not recognize Jesus as the Messiah. And despite coming to His own people, God's covenant people of Israel, even they rejected Him. Then as we're about to read here, this awesome stipulation is stated that applied to believers then and on through today. How many know that the Word of God was not just for those at that time? It is for you and I today. It is to be acted upon, reacted to, lived out today. Amen? It's not just some religious book that we read to see how smart we are, how many scriptures we can memorize. Amen? It is a blueprint, it's a map for how we live, how we treat one another. Amen? And so in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, we'll begin reading with verse 12. This is his account here. He says of Jesus, he says, "But as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God. To those who believe, in His name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." Hallelujah. Amen. I am glad of that today. The Lord has something to say. This is more of a kind of a teaching type thing that we probably would do on like a Wednesday night. But I believe I've got a receptive crowd here today that wants to have power and knowledge, the power that would come from that knowledge, imparted into their spirits today. So I hope you've not come for just another service, just another ritual. I hope you've come to encounter the Holy Spirit. I hope you have come to be empowered from on high by God. Amen? I want to ask you today, are you ready to hear from heaven? If so, heaven's ready to hear from you. Are you ready for the Word today? Come on and give Him a shout of praise for that. Pastor Jason, would you stand and just pray aloud today and declare victory over this gracious
Heavenly Father, God, right now, dear God.
Hallelujah.
We are so humble. We're so blessed to have You in our presence, God. Dear Heavenly Father, as I praise and I worship this moment to You, dear Heavenly Father, You have indeed led us here with Your presence, God. So thank You for all the things that You've done in this service so far. Thank You for the testimonies, the miracles, dear Heavenly Father, that just further increase our faith, dear God. Now right now, dear Heavenly Father, I pray, bless Him over our pastor. I pray, anoint Him over our pastor. God, right now, give Him the words to say that He hasn't even thought about saying yet, dear God. You put in Him a word, dear Heavenly Father, that will bless every person in this church, that there will be seeds planted and growth come from this, dear Heavenly Father. We pray, dear God, You're going to bless us, bless this church, dear God, and we will look back on this Sunday as a Sunday that growth happened, dear Heavenly Father. Father.
Amen.
This Sunday as a Sunday, when things finally began to get in shape, things finally started happening, dear Heavenly Father.
Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're getting on one page, one accord, dear God. We give you all the praise, dear God. Bless our pastor. Turn him loose this morning, dear Heavenly Father. In your most holy name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Thank you so much, Lisa. You guys can come up with the lights. And amen. Today's message is titled, The Beauty of Believing and Receiving. I want you to just feel that title today. Amen. Say it with me. The Beauty of Believing and Receiving. Amen. As a child, one of my favorite TV shows was called The A-Team. Anybody remember the A-Team?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Murdoch, Face, B.A., and Colonel John Hannibal Smith. He was played by actor George Peppard. And a famous line that he would always say. Anybody want to say it with me? I love it when a plan comes together. He would look back at the destruction that the A-Team had just caused. The blown up buildings, the wrecked cars and trucks, the bullet holes in them. Nobody got killed.
Right.
They just shot at their feet. Amen. With AK-47s and M16s. But as a kid, I just looked forward to Friday night. The A-Team was so good, it pulled me away from the Dukes of Hazzard. They came over at the same time. Dukes of Hazzard was kind of in its last season, I believe. It was kind of fading off. Because I had been a Dukes of Hazzard fan, man. I had everything. I had the car, I had the guitar, everything. But it kind of faded off, and I became all into the A-Team on Friday nights. But he would say, I love it when a plan comes together. Admiring things falling into place is a thing of beauty. This year I had a college soccer coach that was teaching my son soccer, explaining the fundamentals of the sport, and he referred to it as a beautiful game. And he was from South Africa, so he talked with an accent, and he began to tell me, and he calls me Daniel. And he would begin to tell me that when you get this into place and you get that into place and you put it together, he said, it's a beautiful soccer game when you see those things happen. And any coach, when a coach of a football team gets his defense and his offense working, his special teams working, it's a beautiful thing when you see those plans come together. Amen? But for the golfers out there, when you finally start to put some things in place, it's a beautiful thing to see you finally starting to kind of get it and it coming around, even though it's still hard to ever make a birdie. Amen. But it's a beautiful thing when you start to see things come together. God's salvation plan is an incredible thing. And when the born-again believer walks in God's grace and exemplifies great faith with abundant joy in life, it truly is a thing of beauty. God had a plan for you and I. He told Jeremiah the prophet in chapter 25, verse 11, "For I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a confirmed end, a future." God had a plan for you and I, amen, to send His Son to die on a cross, but not just so that we could escape hell. Hell that we deserve, because we were born into sin. And the Bible says the wages of sin is death. No matter how good you've ever been, we all deserve hell. But Jesus paid the price so we could go free. And we're supposed to be so joyful, so celebratory because of that fact that we walk in power, we walk in joy, we walk in grace, and we walk in peace. And we walk by faith, not by sight.
Amen.
But there's a problem. Too many of God's people are not walking in that reality. Amen? It's a thing of beauty when that happens, when you walk in such a way to know that you're saved, amen? Know that you're on your way to heaven, but know that you can have that abundant life that Jesus said He came for. Hallelujah. Living a life where we believe God and receive that which He said we could have is a beautiful thing. Yet, we get blocked. We get delayed. We get ambushed by the tactics of the enemy. What are those tactics? Well, let me tell you one thing people get caught up in, and they can't seem to walk in the things of God and have the things of God. The trauma that hits your life. the drama that hits your life. Drama causes turmoil. Turmoil robs you of your peace. And what causes drama? A lot of times, stirring up gossip. Amen. I'm here to tell you right now, the Holy Ghost told me recently, if gossip will die in your mouth, drama won't reign in your life. Amen. All anybody's got to do is shut it down, let it down, quit talking about it. Amen. Let your yes be yes, let your no be no. Amen. If you got an issue with somebody, love them in love. Amen. And if it's hashed out, get it done face to face. Don't walk around still having a problem after it's over with. Amen. Don't spend Christmases without each other. Don't spend Thanksgiving without each other. Amen. Don't see each other in public and not be able to talk. That ain't exemplifying the love of God. Amen. That's a bunch of drama mess, and God ain't got time for drama. Neither does your mama. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. How many just despise drama? Come on, Christian. Come on, people. Amen. How many know there's nothing that can happen in life that we can't get over by the love of God? Amen. Everybody getting on one page and getting over with that stuff. Hallelujah. But those things happen. Guess what else blocks us? Guess what else delays us? Guess what else ambushes us? Fear. Fear. You know why we get fearful? The Bible says our love has not been perfected. Because the Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. Hallelujah. So when you're afraid, there's something wrong with your love. There's something wrong, whether it's your love for other people, or really it's you exemplifying the love of Christ. Jesus loves everybody. If you'll forgive everybody, if you'll have love in your heart, then when you face the things that come and attack your life, you won't live in fear. You won't react with fear. You'll react with faith.
Amen.
Because fear is the opposite of faith, and fear kills faith. And I don't want faith to kill, because God has given us all a measure of faith. Everyone. But it's up to us how we react. It's up to us how we exemplify it. Let's look back at the text today. Amen. We're talking about believing and receiving. Let's look back at John chapter 1 verse 12. Now it says, as many as received Him. Somebody say received Him.
Received.
As many as received Him. They received it. A lot of people don't receive things. You can't give a gift to somebody if they refuse to receive it. You can't do something for someone if they say no. Amen? You can try. You can love on them. Amen? Hallelujah. If they reject you, I'm going to tell you, Jesus said something strong about rejection. We've got a message coming up before too long about rejection. Here's how. You know how bad rejection is? When Christians reject other Christians. When spouses reject their spouse, when friends reject friends, when rejection happens, here's how strong Jesus feels about rejection. He told his apostles, when you go into a town and you preach the gospel, if they reject it and you just can't get through, He said, leave that place, take your feet and wipe the dust off your feet and walk away. He said, Sodom and Gomorrah is better off than they are, and Sodom and Gomorrah burn up with brimstone and fire. Amen. Jesus feels strong and passionate about the subject of rejection. Amen. So people got to receive instead of reject. But He said here, John said, as many as received Him did reject Him, and many rejected Him, but many received Him. To them, He gave the right to become children of God. You can't be a child of God if you don't receive Jesus Christ. He's the only way to heaven. He's the only way to the Father. Amen. Not Muhammad, not Buddha, not Scientology. Jesus is the way, the only way. Amen. He said, as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become children of God. And look, He follows it up with this. To those who believe in His name. Not somebody that just got on the bandwagon because everybody else was a part of the revival. Everybody else got a part of the fan club. Jesus didn't come so He could have fans. He came so that He could have sincere followers. Amen? And so He says, to those who believe in His name, who were born not of blood, not because they were conceived, but by the but of God, He says. Meaning born again spiritually. You can't even receive salvation unless you believe. Amen. John 3:16 says this. He says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish." Meaning they won't have eternal death. They'll have eternal life. Hallelujah. You can't even get saved unless you believe. You can't get saved because mama told you, boy, you better go get saved. Because grandmama told you, you better go get saved. Because it'll make your marriage just better. It'll cause you and your significant other to get along better. You got to do it. If you do it for somebody else, there's not a good chance it's going to stick. You got to do it for you. Because you believe in what Jesus Christ did on Calvary for you. Amen? All right. So we got to believe in order to receive. Now we're talking about the beauty of believing and receiving. Now here in this scripture, I want you to go to Mark 6:5-6. You guys don't have to turn there because we're going to look at some more before we close out. But the guys will put it on the board for you. Mark chapter 6, verse 56. Now we're talking about the beauty of believing and receiving. And here we see faith exemplified in going after breakthroughs made possible by the power of God. Hallelujah. How many believe in pressing through in prayer?
Amen.
How many have ever pressed through in prayer?
Yes.
How many know that it might take longer than 2 minutes?
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
But we get guilty. We're all guilty, including myself, of not putting that amount of time in to prayer. Verse 56. It says, wherever He, being Jesus, entered. Wherever. It didn't matter. He's no respecter of persons. Wherever He entered into villages, whether it was a city or the country, He loved the city folk and the country folk. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. All the country. They laid the sick in the marketplaces right out front and begged Him that they might just touch the hem of His garment. And it says, and as many as touched Him, somebody shout, touched Him, were made well.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Were made well. There is power in pressing through. We've heard the story of the famous woman who had the issue of blood, and she had gone and sought other physicians, and she had been that way, I want to say, 12 years. And she had gone through all kinds of things, spent all her money, and then she heard that Jesus was coming to town, and she knew that all I got to do is press through this crowd and reach out and grab the hem of His garment. There's enough power in Him if I can just get to where He is. Now, a centurion soldier showed even great faith when he said, Jesus, you don't have to go back home with me. If you'll just speak it, it'll be done. Because I know how that works. He said, I'm a man of authority. If I tell this one to go here, they do it. If I tell this one to do this, they do it. And so Jesus loved that faith. But there's something about, we need to believe in the spoken word. We need to speak what's been imparted into us. But there are times that you're going to have to press through in prayer. That teenager is bachelored out of church, won't come to youth group no more. They're out doing all kinds of crazy stuff. You don't know what to do. You raised them up right. You raised them. Amen. But the devil's attacking your home. You got a spouse that you don't know what's going on. They're working late. And they say they're here. You find out they're not. You don't know what's going on. You've got drama. You've got attacks. You've got financial breakdowns going on. And you don't know what to do. Maybe you need to get on your face and press into the Holy Ghost until that thing breaks. Until it breaks. Hallelujah. Because there's something about knowing Him and saying, if I can just touch God. And a lot of times we don't get through because we've not touched God yet. Hallelujah. And you say, well, does He want us to beg? No, but He does want some of your time. He does want to talk to you. He does want to walk with you. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope this message isn't going to be too hard for a Sunday morning. Amen. Have I got some people that can take it?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So pressing through. There's power in pressing through. You believe what you're going after. You don't intently and determine yourself and purpose yourself to go after something you don't believe in. You don't trust. Hallelujah. God's got to lay it on your heart for you to go do that. And you certainly know that God's laying on your heart to go here and go there for a breakthrough. Certainly we go to Him first. Hallelujah. Give me James chapter 5. James chapter 5. Now the beauty of believing and receiving certainly works through the power of prayer. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
How many believe in the power of prayer?
Amen.
Our faith in Him releases power. Let me say that again. I don't think you caught it. Our faith in Him releases power.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Our faith in Him releases power. Also, our humble brokenness and our honesty unleashes His breakthrough power.
Yes.
In the book of James, he writes to a church saying, is anyone among you sick? People have been getting healed at record numbers at that time. During the start of the church, the early church in the apostolic age, it was hard to find a sick person. So many people were getting healed. People were exemplifying great faith. The great revival was going on. It was establishing the early Christian church. And he said, hey, is anybody among you sick? He said, if they are, let them call on the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, meaning the anointed people of the church. Hallelujah. He said, let them pray over him. And listen, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. We practice that till today. That wasn't just for them to do then. We do it now. I walked in a hospital room the other day, pulled out a prayer cloth, doused it down with anointing oil, and prayed over a brother. Amen? We had prayer right then, the prayer of faith right then. It said in verse 15, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. You got to be faithful in your prayer. You got to know that what you're praying, I'm not just doing this because I was told to. No, I believe in who I'm talking to. I believe in the power that He can release. Amen? But He's got to be pleased. And He's not pleased without faith. It's impossible to please Him without faith. Amen? He wants to see faith. He wants to see that we believe. Hallelujah. The prayer of faith will save the sick and the Lord will raise him up. And if he's committed sins, he will be forgiven. People get saved right here in church because they come and they repent. They come and they ask for forgiveness, not from me, not from you, but from him. He says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. What has sin got to do with healing? What is that all about? Tell you business? No. But he's saying in that those early times, he said, something's being established here. The church of Jesus Christ. Hold one another accountable. You've got something precious. You're in the starting stages of something precious. And there's people in here right now. You're accountable to people that pray with you. You're accountable to people you can confide in. You can't be in covenant with everybody. Amen? Don't try to be. You know who you can trust. And it hurts you if you confide in someone and you find out they went and told three or four other people. So learn your lesson. Let God lead you in who to confide in. Amen. But we got to be accountable to one another, but mostly be accountable to the Holy Ghost. Because even though you can hide your sin from everybody you know, but you can't hide anything from the Holy Spirit. Because He's not gone anywhere. He's right here. And that you may be healed. So could it be that unaddressed sin could block somebody from receiving a healing? We want a breakthrough. We want healing. But we don't want to stop sinning in this area or that area. Amen? And God says, I'll have all of you. Amen? He says, and now, I'm not preaching about a brutal dictator today that's standing there with a gavel saying, oh, you've done too much. You've done too much. No! But I am talking about someone who is real. And if he's real, then we need to get real. We need to get real, and we need to be real for Him, in front of Him. Amen? Hallelujah. He says, the effective. How many want your prayers to be effective?
Amen.
If I spend any time in anything, I want some effectiveness. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want it to be effective. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. What's fervent mean? Passionate. Intense. There's nothing wrong with being passionate and intense about your prayer life. Don't worry about what somebody says your shout sounds like or what somebody says your praise looks like. There's a lot of people in church today that won't even lift their hands to the God who saved them from hell because they're worried about what somebody else thinks. Get your hands up in the air. Says your of faith, they'll be effective if they're fervent. He says it makes much things, many things, available to you. Available to you. How many want the things of heaven to be available to you? Now, we can walk around just saved and on our way to heaven and endure every hard thing that ever comes our way. And it'd be enough, but man, it'd be a struggle. Thank God He didn't leave us hanging. He said, I am going to send the Comforter. And when I send the Comforter, He shall abide forever. The Holy Ghost was not just for the time of the apostles so they could get the church established. He's still here. Where are we at? He's still here. He still wants to reign in the church of Jesus Christ. He still wants to reign in the Christian home. He still wants to reign in the Christian marriage. Amen? He still wants to reign in those places. But we've got to let Him. Hallelujah. We got to let Him. Hallelujah. Now the beauty of believing and receiving certainly pertains to the gifts of the Spirit. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Listen, a lack of knowledge as well as overthinking or overanalyzing can all hinder receiving as we look at this example. I want to look at this last portion of Scripture. Anybody get anything out of this?
Amen.
Hope I'm not boring you to death.
No.
Give me Acts 19. This will be the last Scripture we look at. Now Paul goes to Ephesus and they believe. But they had limitations. They had repented through John the Baptist's baptism, but didn't have new life in Christ. And what do I mean by that? They remind me of an evangelist in the apostolic age by the name of Apollos. And he crossed paths with Paul. Apollos, too, was on fire for God. He had heard the message of John the Baptist. He had been baptized in the ministry of John the Baptist. And John's baptism says, repent and get ready. Jesus says, here I am. I'm what you've been getting ready for. Walk in it. Amen? But all he knew was John the Baptist, who said, repent and get ready. Somebody's coming after me, the latch of whose sandals I'm not worthy to even loosen. Amen. John even had some questions. He was in jail about to be beheaded, and he sent his people to Jesus and said, are you the one we've been getting ready for? Everybody's going to have questions about things. Amen. But Jesus said, go tell them the blind see.
Hallelujah.
The deaf can hear. The dead are being raised. Yeah. And sins are being forgiven. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And so Apollos was under that knowledge, under that doctrine, until a blessed couple. How many know you don't have to stand behind a pulpit to be evangelists for Jesus Christ? Hallelujah. The blessed couple by the name of Priscilla and Aquila. Amen. They came together and their names rhymed. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. They came together. It's like Mary and Gary or something like that. And so they come together and they find out, they say, man, that guy's a dynamic, charismatic preacher. But he don't have the whole story. He's got an incomplete version here. They bring him into the house. They sit him down. They cook him a good meal. Perhaps they cook him some chicken pastry. Amen. Hallelujah. Perhaps they bake him an apple pie. Praise God. Perhaps they added some collard greens with some ham hock in it. And they sat him down. Got him comfortable. Amen. And they were ever able to impart the full truth. How many want the full truth? I don't want half a gospel. Because I was in sin and I was real, real good at it. I was a professional sinner. So it was going to take a full gospel. It was going to take a complete gospel. Amen? To get me to turn away from what I had been involved in. And so they told him the whole truth. And guess what? You know, he'd have great crowds coming to hear him, Brother Brian. And a lot of times when that happens, here's my swivel. What y'all telling me? Do you know how long I've been preaching? And you're going to try to tell me this stuff? No, he received it because he had the right heart for what he was doing. He had the right heart for what he was doing, and he changed, and he went out and preached the full gospel. The Ephesian people that Paul encountered were just like Apollos. They had heard about John's baptism, but they didn't have the complete knowledge of Jesus Christ. The fact that he had came, he had suffered, he died, he rose again, he ascended to heaven. In verse 2 of Acts 19, are we ready?
Yes.
I want to read this to you. It says, he, Paul, said to them, the Ephesians, he says, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? So they said to him, we have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit. Man, we've not heard anything about that. That we've not gotten that teaching. We've not been taught about it. We don't know anything about it. Paul says, since you believed, have you received? Because if you believe, then you ought to receive. And he says, we've not even heard whether or not there's a Holy Spirit. And Paul says in verse 3, into what then were you baptized? So they said, into John's baptism, John the Baptist. Then Paul said, John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him. After him. That is, on Christ Jesus. So he came in, he taught them the rest of the story. They received it. Look in verse 5. It says, when they heard. When they heard. How many know it's important to come to church so you can hear? Hallelujah. How many know it's important to be in the fellowship of other Christians so that you can, iron sharpens iron and you can encourage one another? How many know we need to be in the Word of God so the Word of God can speak back to us and we can hear? How many know that hearing the Word of God increases our faith? Because faith comes by hearing. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Amen? Hallelujah. The Ephesians here began to flow in the Spirit as they encountered the power of God through a Spirit-filled believer who flowed in the Spirit. A lot of people say, well, I've seen it like this, so this must be what I need to do. Amen? And they are not letting God flow in them. I've seen some crazy stuff. I've seen people before demand that somebody speak in tongues. I've seen them pop them in the mouth, trying to make them tongue. If you pop me in my mouth, do not try to make something that's not happening happen. It ain't genuine, it's not sincere, and God will judge a phony. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Let the power of God sincerely flow. Amen? And if you want to feel His power, then get around some power. If you want to get warm by the fire, you're going to have to get around the fire with everybody else. Because the person that's going to get warm by the fire is the one that gets right up there with everybody else at the fire. You're going to be over here, you're going to freeze, you're going to get cold. If you get a little bit closer, you're going to be lukewarm for a little while. But I don't want to make God sick. I want to get hot, stay hot, and be on fire for Jesus Christ. Okay. Now listen to this. Here's where we're going to get a little bit into some things here. These Ephesian believers were incomplete. They repented, but not experienced the fullness of new life in Christ. Many today are in that same place. You've repented for your wrongdoings. You've turned away. I was an alcoholic, so you quit drinking. You use foul language and profanity came out of your mouth every other sentence, and you stop and you clean your language up. You did the works. You did good deeds. Amen? But you were too focused on, I can't do this, I can't do that. That's what I thought coming to church and being a Christian was all about. To the point that I tried to plan and schedule when I was going to get saved. I was scared. Yeah, the boys were a good time. We're going to skip them. Kick the fattest hog and find. I'm going to drink 27 beers that day. Oh, we're going to do it all. Oh, I'll probably harder even live through it. But once I make it out of there, I'm done. And I'm going to go be a boring Christian. I'm going to go in there.
I'm going to sing. I brought her singing Amazing Grace. I'm going to sing songs to myself. Oh, I can't drink no more. Can't smoke no more. I was writing little country songs in my head. Can't cuss. I was sounding like Merle Haggard in my mind. And I was like this. And I was coming in here saying, well, 2 more weeks, I'm going to do it. 2 more weeks and the end shall come. 2 more weeks and the end shall come. And I thought that that was what it was all about. And God started to do a work inside me. He began to show me all the things He had saved me from. He began to show me how great His love was. How better other people's lives were. He began to show me my cousin, David Frisian, and the peace that he had, and the good human being that he was. He began to show me my cousin, Kevin Parker, and how he enjoyed life. They loved life. They laughed. They were better fathers. They were better husbands, and they were better providers. They hadn't drank up, smoked up, and cussed up all the money away. They had been good stewards of what they had. And I say their names because that's just who God put in my path. That were an example to me. Amen. And then I realized, wait a minute. There's more to life than just this. This is just what I've known. But I can come out of what I've known and learn something else. I've been indoctrinated enough in the world. Now I need to be indoctrinated into the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And it didn't matter what I missed out on. It didn't matter all the things that I turned away from. I realized what I was turning to was so much greater, so much sweeter, and I needed it in my life. And it's gotten sweeter as the days have gone by. It's not gotten boring. I gained more than what I lost, because what I lost was killing me. It was killing me. Hallelujah. And so many people, they'll repent. And maybe they didn't have the past I had. Let me tell you something. There's nothing wrong with you ever not being into the things that I was. It doesn't make my testimony more powerful than yours. Amen? I love to hear a testimony from somebody that got saved, born again, filled with the Holy Spirit at 15 years old, and then lived. They got a testimony too. Or somebody got saved later on in life and they didn't ever go down those roads, but we were all born in sin. Maybe you want an alcoholic. Maybe you want a drug addict. Were you a liar? Were you an adulterer? Were you addicted to pornography? Did you lust? Did you cheat? Lie and steal? Whatever it was, we all need to be saved. But here, people repented, but they weren't walking in the fullness of Christ. And still today, people are repenting, but they're not walking in the fullness of Christ. You know why? That's the reason you see them come through the church, go through the motions, and drift away 3 or 4 months later. Okay, I like what's going on. I like to hear the music. I like to see what everybody's doing. I like that that dynamic speaking there. I like that. I'm touched. I feel some goosebumps. I think, okay, I want that because I've heard that's what you're supposed to do. And you come, and oh, you want to lift my hands up? Okay. You don't ever see no tears, though. You don't ever see no brokenness. Tears are a good piece of evidence of brokenness. Amen. We got to get broken. Like the thief on the rock. Amen. He said, remember me. In other words, I'm being dismembered. Put me back together again. I am broken. And Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. You're going where I'm going. And we got, how many want to be where Jesus is? And so we can't just repent. We got to walk in the fullness of His new life for us. And they'll go through the motions. They might even get baptized. They might even join the church. They might even serve in a position. It doesn't matter. Amen. But if they don't, if all they did was repent and they didn't open their heart up to the fullness of Christ, they're not going to stick with it, y'all. Can I say y'all in Sandy Cross? They're not going to stick with it because their heart didn't change. They weren't transformed. Their mind wasn't renewed. They were still holding on to the old things. They were still in the old ways. Amen. Hallelujah. In your former life as a Christian, if you were an alcoholic, you might have to stay out of the bar room. If you were an adulterer, then you need to, guys, if you were an adulterer, you've got to watch how you act around other women. And
and respect your wife. You can't put yourself in those places, amen? Come on, somebody. If you had problems with those things, if you had problems with drugs, you have to stay away from your friends that are still doing them. Amen? So that you can come into the newness of Christ. Hallelujah. And if you want to get educated, indoctrinated, hallelujah, I'm going to tell you, you are in a church who is doing more than we ever have to disciple people and teach them the Word of God. Amen? To raise up stronger Christians, because that's what we want to see. We're raising up an army. God has commandeered us to raise up an army in these last days. Amen? And we're not playing with it. We want people to get stronger and walk into the fullness of Christ. Now I'm going to give this one more point. People are still repenting, but they're not walking in the fullness of Christ. Number two on that, you know, the first one was, you know, you see people who go through the motions. Number two, guess what? People might have come from a background of limited teachings. Limited teachings due to denominational beliefs. Denominational separation that can cause people to not walk in the fullness of God. I encountered a man the other day, and when I went to the counter to be rung up, he was an older man was sitting over there, and the man behind the counter knew me. He called me Pastor Daniel. It's good to see you today, Pastor Daniel. And the man over there said, "Where are you a pastor at?" And I said, "I told him where the church was and whatnot." He said, "Well, where did you get your education from?" I looked at him and I said, "Life." Amen. Life. He said, "What do you mean? What seminary did you go to? What school, Bible college?" I said, "I didn't have time." He said, "What do you mean you didn't have time?" I said, "When God called me, it was a right now thing. And I had on-the-job training." Amen. He said, "Man, I ain't never heard of that." I said, "Well, this November we'll be celebrating 8 years, so somebody's doing something right somewhere, and I believe it's the Holy Ghost." Amen. He said, "Well, I've been," and he said his denomination, "for 75 years. I said, "Well, praise God, brother. I'm glad you're faithful to your church. Hey, but when we get to heaven one day, we're all going to be there together. There's not going to be a section for this denomination or that denomination." He said, "Well, I don't know if I'm going to heaven with all the things I've been doing." He's been sitting in church for 75 years and still don't know whether or not he's going to heaven. Amen. You said that, I did. Glory to God. Man decided to separate. Jesus prayed in the garden for you and I. He said, "I pray they all be one." Then man started saying, "Well, I believe in this, so I'm going to have to separate. And I believe in this, so I'm going to have to separate." And then what happened was limited teachings. And they just said, "You know what? The gifts of the Spirit and people get supernaturally healed, speaking in tongues and prophesying and all that. You know what? That was just for the apostolic age to get the church started. We don't have that anymore. Don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost." Let me tell you something. When Jesus prayed for the Comforter to come, He said He would come and it would abide forever. The Holy Ghost is still here. It is up to the believer whether or not they want to feel the tangible, powerful presence of God. And I'm here to tell you right now, I don't want church without the presence of God. Hallelujah. I want to be filled with the Holy Ghost. When I first started coming back to church, I had seen people fall out as a child. I thought to myself, that is nonsense. A circus? That is crazy. When I came back to the church and I saw somebody fall, I said, "Somebody call an ambulance for them." And then after I got saved, I stood in that and I was a little weary about whether or not I was going to come to church here. But I came because God led me and because the man of God that stood behind this pulpit loved me. And every time he saw me walk out of that store that he lived beside with a case of beer in my hand, he never judged me. He waved at me and said, "Hey, son, love you." And I would hold my head down because of what I had in my hand. But he never judged me. And whether I came to church or not, he was there for me. Yes. Hallelujah. So that helped too. Yes. That helped too. But one night, a couple of weeks after I got saved,
I saw this, just like Brother James has seen something supernatural take place. I saw a supernatural sight. Y'all might think I'm loony, but I saw that squared area right there that that cross and that stained glass is in. It became a movie screen. It became a movie screen. Not because there's screens on each side. I was able to see visions of my life. And he showed me that night things he had done for me. Times when I thought I had alcohol poisoning. Where I had more alcohol in my system than my blood level was. And I thought I was dying. He showed me a wreck where I crashed into a house. Got out of it, crawled out of it, and was alive. He showed me so many things that could have happened to me. He showed me how when I was an 8-year-old boy, and I got down on my knees, I said, God, if you'll just do this for me, put my mom and my dad back together. And he showed me when I was 10 years old, that daddy come, and he was with mama, and he said, get in the truck. We're all going home together. Amen. He showed me when I was in my 20s, and I said, God, help me clean up my act so that I can get the mother of my child back and I can raise my son together. And after 9 years of separation, we got back together. Amen. Raised that boy. He's an awesome kid. We had another child, and now we got a grandbaby. He reminded me of all he had done for me. And I was so overwhelmed by the vision God gave me. I was baptized in the Holy Ghost right then, amen? And I fell flat on my back. And when I came out of that glorious presence of seeing, hallelujah, the feet of Jesus Christ, when I saw His power, amen, fell into the throne room, hallelujah, as I began to come to, I heard the voice of my pastor saying, He's all over you, son. Just enjoy it. That which I used to think was nonsense, that which I used to think was a bunch of crazy stuff, got a hold of this old boy. And now, I'm a believer. And because I believe, I receive. Amen. Don't limit yourself from what God wants to do for you, what He wants to do in you. Amen. If you'll believe, you'll receive. Hallelujah. If you'll believe, you'll receive. Amen. So I close with this. Come on, Sister Lisa. We're talking about believing and receiving. We're talking about how beautiful the aspect of believing and receiving coming together is. The enemy despises that which is beautiful. Do you know that? You know why he does? Because he was once beautiful himself in heaven as an angel known as Lucifer. He was the first praise and worship leader. He had a job in heaven. And he got so adored, he became so prideful, he thought he could do a better job than God. And God kicked him out of heaven. And he went from being a beautiful angel to becoming an ugly monster. An ugly monster. And so he wants to destroy the beautiful things of God. First thing he wants to destroy is people's salvation. And he can, he has, and he will. Now, it's a profound thing, but I believe that a born-again Christian can walk away from their covenant. I believe that. I believe that. So he wants to destroy people's salvation. He wants to destroy the Christianity. Guess what else he loves to destroy? Marriage. Oh, he loves that. He loves to make a marriage full of rejection. He loves to make a marriage full of indifference. He loves to make a marriage just something you got to struggle through instead of something you got to enjoy. He loves to make a marriage something that people give up on just because it's going to take a little work. He loves that. And guess what he loves? He especially loves it when he attacks the marriage that has said, we have a Christian marriage. Oh, he comes after that with everything he's got. Because when he can destroy the Christian marriage, he can take from the church. He can also take from God's reputation. And he loves trying to take from God's reputation. He loves to destroy the Christian. He loves for a Christian to say one thing and do another. Amen? He loves to see Christians who say, I'll live for you forever. He loves to see them fall into sin and fornicate. He loves to see them be tempted and give in. He loves it. He
see Christian teenagers not wait for marriage before they have sex. He loves them to go ahead and start now. He loves that because every time he can get somebody to go against what they said they do for God, he thinks he's showing God, you're not powerful enough. I'm more powerful in their life than you are. Oh, does this resonate with anybody? Go on, let it step on your toes. It's all right. It's just as good for you as anything. Just as good as gravy for you. He loves that. He wants to destroy our salvation, our marriages. He wants to destroy people's faith in God. Pastor, we've seen people we pray for die of cancer. How can we believe he's going to heal the next one of cancer? Pastor, it looks to me like he's picking and choosing who he wants to save and heal. You don't know what the plan of God is for people's lives. Amen? You don't know how God decides to use people. Hallelujah. We will never know everything until we sit around His throne one day. And then one day, He can reveal to us what He wants. We talked about Wednesday night how scientific research proved that what makes us up, the cells that make us up, have not reached their full potential. You know what I believe that means? It's scientific evidence that we have yet awaiting for us a higher level of living called the glorified body. And God's not going to let us get there yet. You know why? Because the rapture's not come yet. Because sin has not been ended yet. The devil's not been thrown into the lake of fire yet. Amen? So until then, we got to deal with these bodies. But I'm not going to walk around saying, oh, I got an ache. I think I'm dying. I've got a sore. I think it's cancer. This one's in my family, that one's in my family. This must be happening to me. Please, don't ever call any of those sicknesses yours. It's not yours. It belongs to the devil. It don't belong to God. It don't belong to His people.
That's right.
Amen? And I don't have all this figured out yet, but I am here to tell you, I'd rather pray and believe for healing. I'd rather walk by faith, not by sight. I'd rather embrace grace every day to embrace a struggle.
That's right.
Amen? And I'm going to stand on my own two feet on the Word of God as a Christian. I'm not going to have to be spoon-fed. I'm not going to have my hand held. I'm not going to have to be caught or cuddled. Hallelujah. I'm going to stay. If I make a mistake, I'm all up to it. I'm not going to try to live both ways. We are in the last days and God don't have time anymore for all the pity parties that His people want to throw. You either want to live for Him or you don't. You either want to worship in His house or you don't. Hallelujah. But this train is heading to heaven. Amen. I want everybody to stay aboard. If you jump off, come on, catch up with us. We'll reach out our hand. Amen. And wherever we're short, He'll reach His hand even further. And He'll pull you back on the train. Hallelujah. But we're going to believe in this house and we're going to receive because we believe in this awesome God that we serve. The devil don't want you to receive, so he chips away at what you believe. Don't let him chip away at what you believe anymore. Please don't. We're in the last days now. That's not being said in a lot of churches. Because it doesn't feel huge. But God didn't call me to feel huge. He called me to declare His truth. He didn't call me to be a referee. He didn't call me to be a sheriff's deputy. Come on. He didn't call me to be a judge. He didn't call me to be a psychiatrist. He called me to be a declarer of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The greatest way this preacher can help you is from right here. Every Sunday and every Wednesday. Till I take a break. I'm one of these awesome people in the church that have been called to preach, bring the truth. Amen. And what we're going to do is we're going to be here. Preachers, can I get an amen?
Amen.
We're going to be here and we're going to declare the truth. And we're going to tell you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help us, God. We want you to be here so that your faith can rise, so that you can believe at an even higher level, and so that you can receive on a higher level. How many is ready to receive?
Amen.
Stand in the feet of that. Hallelujah.